conformal field theory. Here's some useful references. This is maybe the most standard book you can find, but unfortunately there is no perfect book for this kind of thing. Very special, 1+1 dimensional theory is a conformal field theory. We're going to have in mind the Pollard curve of action, which has this wild symmetry. To avoid confusion, in general relativity, this is sometimes called a conformal transformation itself, but here we're going to mean something slightly different by that, so bear with me. Usual quantum field theory, like QED, can be described by a world line formalism, as described beautifully in these lectures. If a photon comes in, we usually think of it breaking up into electron-positron pair and then forming a photon, but now we can think of a vertex insertion, where there's a vertex in the quantum field theory diagram. And then instead, integrate these vertices over the world line is what you're trying to integrate over, and the important question becomes about singularity. When does this approach this? What happens with this integral? In perturbative string theory, questions are very similar. There's a world sheet in 1+1 dimension, so space and time, although we might go Euclidean and have two space. An important question is, when is the integral of the distance between these two vertices? What happens to it when the distance goes to zero? So the important question when an operator comes close to another operator is there a singularity? And I have another video about that. The Schwinger-Dyson equation tells you that if there's a delta function in the Green's function equation, then we may have to subtract something. And this bosonic Green's function is exactly what you have to add to this to get something that's completely well-defined as z goes to zero. You can have a composite operator getting close to the first operator. This t is the normal order product of dx dx. So at some point you get tired of putting out the colons here. This one can get close to this, or this one can get close to this. And then you get two times the contraction of a single dx with a dx. And each contraction gives you these kind of shifts that you have up here. There are two ways to state Noether's theorem, and the first one you should be familiar with from classical field theory. If you vary your field, you will find a variation of the Lagrangian. If it can be expressed as a total derivative that vanishes when you integrate, then you still have them symmetric current. We're going to use a slightly different version of this here, and in Polchinski prove their equivalence. You're going to say I deform the variation, so I multiply by a rho function that has compact support, so it's non-zero, only close to some point, and they extract the coefficient of derivative rho. Why is it going to be derivative? Well, we knew that if this was constant and we had a symmetry, so if we deform this, we're not going to have a symmetry, but the variation should be proportional to the derivative of this deformation rho. So this is another way to extract the current J. You can do it either way. This will be convenient for us. So here's an example. You vary one of the world sheet coordinates. So this is sigma 1, sigma 2, or space and time on the world sheet, let's say. And then the variation in the embedding function x mu, so a bunch of scalar fields on the world sheet in the 1+1 dimension, they vary like this. If you're confused about the minus signs, think about these active versus passive transformations in Noether's theorem. So here's the variation of the Pollard curve action. Now let's deform. So we're going to put in this rho we had before. We're going to allow rho to depend on the coordinates. And then we're going to act with this derivative. So we get two terms. And then we can use a trick that we rewrite this derivative of v using a Kronecker delta. So we can factor out dA rho. Now we have some object here that we're going to call the stress energy tensor. So the symmetry current that we read off from this manipulation is JA is imaginary unit I times VB TAB, where TAB is the stress energy tensor that we've seen before if you've seen my other videos. In general, the conservation of the current J can be written in terms of components. So this is first component, second component. We can write that in complex coordinates, as I discussed in the other video. Usually the J's are written with index down. So JZ down is J, because you only have this off-diagonal Z bar Z. Incidentally, the J without the dot you make like this in tech. Now we notice something. If V doesn't depend on Z bar and TZ doesn't depend on Z bar, and this component J tilde is zero, so if this is not there, any holomorphic J leads to a conserved current. This is a very useful thing to check. The whole thing we just did is just an example that if the current only has the J component and it's holomorphic, then it's conserved. Now, what about this equation up here? Let's check it. So the trace of the stress energy tensor can be written in complex coordinates like this. And in fact, you only get this part. If it's zero, then TZ Z bar is zero. If you pick this B to be, for example, Z bar, you see that you have this kind of equation. If your stress energy tensor is traceless and conserved, in fact, the del T tilde is zero. So T tilde is just a function of Z bar. And similarly, you can have T is just a function of Z. This is pretty amazing. We have an infinity of possible V of Z that lead to conserved current. But what is this transformation? If you have a complex variable z, you might know from complex analysis that a holomorphic map that only depends on z and not z bar preserves angles but not areas. So for example, the Mercator projection that is the usual one used in school atlases, it looks like Greenland is a lot bigger than Australia. But if you put them on top of each other, Greenland is smaller than Australia. So a conformal transformation is a holomorphic map that preserves infinitesimal angles or infinitesimal squares, but it doesn't preserve areas. In another video I discuss the equatorial stereographic projection, which is to us a more directly relevant projection than the Mercator projection. The north and the south stereographic projection are switched by z goes to 1 over z. as is easy to see if you work out the relation between these two representations. So what is a conformal transformation to us? Well, when you change z to z prime, let's say, the metric will actually change. It'll be rescaled by something. And this look, when you first look at it, it looks kind of general, but actually it's not general. In general, you would have a matrix structure here. When you do a homomorphic transformation on this metric, you just get a factor up front. Then you use the Weyl symmetry to bring it back to the unit metric. So in Polchinski's book, in the glossary, he writes that conformal transformations are the subgroup of diffeomorphisms times Weyl transformations that leave invariant the flat metric. Notice this is different from GR, where a conformal transformation is any position-dependent rescaling of the metric, which we call a Weyl transformation. So again, conformal means first do homomorphic map, and then use the Weyl symmetry to bring it back to unit metric. Again, we had an infinite number of symmetries somehow. So why did I say this is an infinite symmetry? If you think of this deformation as a function, then it has an infinite number of parameters in general. You can identify the generators of this symmetry as these derivatives. This is the Lie algebra vector fields on the Riemann sphere, the complex plane including the north pole, as it were. This is homomorphic except at two fixed points, and it's called the Witt algebra. You can compute the commutator of these derivative operators, and you'll find this algebra. This is so far completely classical, but the Jacobi identity of this Lie algebra allows non-trivial central one-parameter generalization, which is called Virasoro. Let's get back to that in a little bit. How do we implement these symmetries in the quantum theory? Classically, dA, gA equals zero. So in the quantum mechanical case, we can have a delta function on the right-hand side, where this is the variation of the operator, insert at a point. More concretely, we can use the divergence theorem to rewrite this in terms of an integral of a current times operator. We see the residue here gives us the variation. So this directly corresponds to this equation up here, from having delta functions in your classical conservation equations. And the operator product expansion is the concept that captures transformation properties and commutators, like in quantum mechanics. So let's see how that works. Let's start with the commutators. So we expand the field dx in terms of z, and there's some conventional factor up front. So this has dimension, and this is dimensionless. And there's a similar one for the bar. If you have this, you can invert it to say that my coefficients, my expansion coefficients, here they're Laurent modes. If z was e to the minus iw, then this would be Fourier modes. And the contour integration here is a small circle around z equals zero. So you pick out these modes by performing these contour integrals. But this immediately leads us to a trick. To extract the commutator, if you have these kind of products, you can write a double, you can write a commutator of integrals, where this means that the order of these integrations is shifted. First you do z2, then z1, and you do z1 and z2. Why does this matter? This looks like functions here. And we'll see in a moment how this relates to operator ordering quantum mechanics, but here we're picturing this in the functional integral, and we think about OPs here. How do we do this contour integration? Well, first fix z2. Then you first do the integration of z1 outside, and then you do the integration of z1 inside, so you haven't done z2 yet. If you think about it, you can then think of this. This is going the other way with a minus sign, so you can draw it inside here, and you can do deformation to just get to this part. So you're doing z1 around z2, and then you do the z2 integration. This amounts to, you first do the OP here, you pick out this residue, and you perform the z2 integral. And you get what you expect. The commutation relation of these modes is a rescaled harmonic oscillator algebra. You can keep going with this. T times some operator is a bunch of singular terms plus higher order terms. You're going to see in a moment how to extract this coefficient h. But let's first define a conformal primary operator is one that doesn't have these extra singular terms here. You can compute the transformation of this operator under application of this T, and you find this. This is the infinitesimal version of a conformal transformation where the operator has weight h. An example is if z prime is a complex number times z, then this is just rescaling by r and rotation by theta. So this is what we were talking about before. So this is a concrete conformal transformation generated by T. Here was my example that I had before. Now we can do this explicitly. The contraction is this thing I said here, and then we know what this is. The second derivative of the bosonic Green's function on the plane, it's the thing itself is minus log z, so this is just that. And then this you can now expand around zero, just use the Taylor expansion, and now you have this result. So we can read off what is the weight of this operator dx, is the coefficient here. So we see that has weight 1, it's the coefficient of this term. Similar to modes of xz, we can mode expand t, and those modes are called L. So the modes of x were called alpha, and the modes of t are called L. They could have just been called T, but that name is reserved for modes in the cylinder frame W that we can reach from a conformal transformation. Z is e to the minus iw. The L's are similar to modes of x. We can find algebra modes from this by the same kind of trick. So instead of having dx dx, now we have tt. So again, we first fix z2, then we do the z1 integrations. It's sometimes useful, as Polchinski does, to draw three contours. Notice that here the Z1 has to be outside the Z2, and here's inside the Z2, but Z2 is fixed. So it's useful to picture three contours, where C2 is the Z2 contour. So first you do the first one, and then you get the C1 minus C3, and then you do the Z2 integration. So this is just another way to say the same thing. But all these tricks with the contours should correspond to something in the operator version of the theory. And in fact, this is made explicit in Polchinski's appendix. You can cut open the functional integral. You can slice it at some radius, which corresponds to time. So this is a time ordering. And then you get the operator interpretation in terms of time order products of operators. So this is a calculation we have to do now. It's very explicit. T is not guaranteed to be a conformal primary. It will have this sort of anomalous term and the other terms we got used to from before. Now we have to compute the residue of this object. Z1 to the n plus 1 is a shift. And then you just do a binomial expansion here. And you remember how you define the residue. You just pick out the right term in a Laurent expansion. Now you can go ahead and do it explicitly. The result is this. And then collecting these terms, you get this. So the total residue looks like that. We still have the Z2 integral left. Doing that, we get the Virasoro algebra. So the central charge term is the extra term compared to what we had before in the Witt algebra. The algebra is infinite dimensional, as we already commented. You notice that L-1, L0, and L1 form a closed subalgebra. In physics, often written with capital. In mathematics, often with SL fracture, like this. And this C, you can think of physically as a Casimir energy. It stands for central charge, but Tong says C is for Casimir to help you remember that this can be thought of as a Casimir energy associated with finite size going from the plane to the cylinder. The cylinder has finite size, and the transformation of T not being conformal primary transforms with an extra anomalous term, and this is controlled by this coefficient C. Now, the operator product expansion is enormously simplified in conformal field theory because you can apply rigid translations, scale transformations, and rotations to make sure that your expansion coefficients are just some given functions times some constants. This is enormously simplified compared to having some general function of the distances in your operator product expansion. In particular, for the two-point function, if you just take two operators, it's completely fixed in terms of some normalization constant by applying these symmetries to your two-point function, as discussed in this part of Polchinski. So similarly, the three-point function is determined in terms of some constants, h, that are the weights of these operators, and some normalization. Classically, we had the Witt algebra. We said quantum, we allow delta coincident points, and Virasoro algebra is the central extension of the Witt algebra. Now we can do a representation of the Virasoro algebra. So L minus 1 on an operator is implemented by a contour integral that just gives you a derivative of the operator. So for dx, this would be d squared x. If you act with L0, it's easy to convince yourself, you just get the weight out. L0 acts on the state O, corresponding to the operator O, this h coefficient in your P. Now this is a radial dilation, as you can convince yourself from up here. This is what in quantum mechanics would have been the energy, but here you should think of it as the conformal weight, the weight under radial rescalings. So let's consider the worksheet fermions. B and C, their weight adds up to 1. The classical equation motions follow from this action. The Green's function to these equations turns out to be 1 over Z. So you can check this easily by saying everywhere except 0, this is obviously holomorphic. And at 0, you can do an integral to show that this is actually a delta function times 2 pi. This means the Witt contraction is in fact this Green's function, as we did for the bosons earlier. What's this useful for? We have ghost fields that are like this. For them, lambda equals 2, so the weights are 2 and minus 1. It's not unitary because hc is minus 1. Another example is lambda equals 1/2, gives you the psi bar that you're used to. Those would be the usual worksheet fermions. They have weight 1/2. B and C are a slight generalization of the usual fermions they would picture in 1 plus 1 dimensions that turn out to be the superpartners of the bosonic embedding fields x. Now this action has a symmetry, that's j is minus bc. It's classically conserved, it just counts number of particles. So it's like the electric charge in QED. This current has a non-tensor transformation property if lambda is not equal to 1/2. So we'll get back to this later. This means that just like T itself, the ghost current does not transform simply under conformal transformations such as Z goes to 1 over Z. In fact, Polchinski discusses a mysterious theory called the linear dilatancy of T. This will turn out to be the first example of a scalar with background charge. What does this mean? TZ plays a special role in string theory. It tells us how to couple to curved metric. But everything in these sections is flat space. In fact, what's going on is that the extra terms in stretch-ended tensor that Polchinski writes down, they know about this because the sphere is curved. We'll work on the Riemann sphere. And pushing the curvature infinity means that the background charge we can think of as being associated with a north pole. For BC ghosts, we get a factor of 3 here. So that means that the integral over some current j actually transforms with a shift of 3. This corresponds to the need to insert 3 C ghosts in chapter 6 when we compute correlation functions. Properties of the ghost current lead to the Riemann-Roch theorem, which is very important. And in topological twisting, which I will not talk much about, you can use this ghost current to redefine the stretch-ended tensor to actually get vanishing central charge. So this is an advanced topic, but it's of great interest. We talked about conformal primary operators, and how do they become vertex operators that I began with? Well, let's take worksheet time to minus infinity. So zooming in here, think of this as a cylinder. You have a state coming in from minus infinity to a time zero, let's say. Then we transform the cylinder to the plane. We insert this at minus infinity corresponds to the origin by this transformation I mentioned before. So the circle here then, as I hinted before, corresponds to time passing from minus infinity up to some time zero. So inserting a vertex operator at the origin, meaning a state coming in from time minus infinity and scattering here in the scattering region, that will be at some finite value of the radial z. Vertex operator is supposed to have weight 1. This operator is not manifestly covariant and it doesn't have weight 1. So we'll have to solve this problem in the superstring. If you want to prepare for that, take a look in this review. Let's summarize. The operator product expansion captures transformation properties of an operator and commutators of modes associated with, for example, the embedding coordinates of the string. The OP is associative, as beautifully pictured at the Simon Center by this artist. Thank you.